Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hola, soy Brenda Romagnello, tu profesora de español. Hello, my name is Brenda Romagnello and I'm your Spanish teacher. Hoy vamos a ver los pronombres de interrogación. Today, we're going to have a look at the WH questions in Spanish. So, we say and we call them WH questions in English because most of these questions will start with a WH in English. So the translation will be with a WH question. But that is certainly not the case, of course, in Spanish. So what they are called is actually pronombres de interrogación. And we use them to ask questions in Spanish. So let's put your knowledge to the test a little bit as well. And let's see if you know what these questions mean in Spanish. And then if you don't know, I'll teach you and then I'll give you some examples as well. Número uno. ¿Qué? 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 ¿Qué significa? It means what. Por ejemplo, ¿qué prefieres comer hoy? What do you prefer to eat today? Número 2. ¿Cuándo? ¿Cuándo? ¿Cuándo significa when? And we use it to talk about time. Por ejemplo, ¿cuándo vuelves de tus vacaciones? When are you coming back from your holidays? Número 3. ¿Dónde? ¿Dónde significa where? And we use it to talk about a location. Por ejemplo, ¿dónde vives? Where do you live? Número 4. ¿Cómo? ¿Cómo? ¿Cómo significa how? Por ejemplo, ¿cómo prefieres tu carne? How do you like your steak cooked? Número 5. ¿Por qué? ¿Por qué significa why? Por ejemplo, ¿por qué estudias español? Why do you study Spanish? Número 6. ¿Cuál and cuáles? ¿Cuál and cuáles significa which? But hang on a second, we have two questions here. So, can you tell me what the difference between cuál and cuáles is? Do you know why we have two options for which in Spanish? The answer to this question is because it's going to depend on the number. So, if we're talking about only one thing, we're going to say cuál. So, cuál is for the singular. And cuáles will be the plural form when we talk about two or more things. Por ejemplo, ¿cuál es tu casa? Which one is your house? ¿Cuáles son tus documentos? Which are your documents? Número 7. ¿Quién and quiénes? So again, here we're going to have two options, and it means in English who. So again, why do you think we have two options here? ¿Quién and quiénes? Exactly the same as cuál and cuáles. ¿Quién is going to be used to refer to one person and quiénes is the plural form and we're going to use it for two people or more. Por ejemplo, ¿quién es tu mejor amigo? Who is your best friend? ¿Quiénes son tus hermanas? Who are your sisters? Número 8. And the last one. ¿Cuánto, cuánta? ¿Cuántos, cuántas? ¿Cuánto and cuántas significa how much? And we are going to use these two options with uncountable nouns, so things that we cannot count or measure. And also, we have two options for how much because cuánto is going to be used, we're going to match it with a masculino. Sustantivo masculino. So we're going to match it with an uncountable noun that has to be masculino. And cuánta will be the femenino form. Por ejemplo, ¿cuánto dinero hay? How much money is there? So dinero es masculino, we have to say cuánto. ¿Cuánta azúcar quieres en el café? How much sugar would you like in your coffee? So azúcar es femenino y vamos a decir cuánta. So we're going to say cuánta for azúcar because it's femenino. ¿Cuántos, cuántas significa how many? And we use these two options with countable nouns, so things that we can count. And again, we're going to differentiate cuántos for nouns that are masculino and cuántas for femenino. ¿Cuántos limones necesitas? How many lemons do you need? ¿Cuántas naranjas necesitas? How many oranges do you need? Muy bien, so that is the lesson for today. I really hope that you liked it and you enjoyed it. If you did, give it a thumbs up. And I will be seeing you next class. Nos vemos la próxima clase. Adiós.
Hola, soy Romina Romagnello, tu profesora de español. Hello, I'm Romina Romagnello, your Spanish teacher. Today I'm going to talk to you about one of the most important and frequently used verbs in Spanish. El verbo querer. The verb querer. When you start learning Spanish, you're going to notice that we use the verb querer all the time. And you might be wondering, what does querer mean? ¿Qué significa querer en español? What does it mean? Querer is often translated as like I like you or I want you. And then it can also mean like I want or I wish. So depending on what are you talking about, this verb is going to be translated into English as either I want or I wish. So let's start talking about wishes. I'll give you an example. Un ejemplo. Yo quiero tener una casa grande. I want to have a big house. Please repeat. Yo quiero tener una casa grande. Yo quiero tener una casa grande. Yo quiero tener una casa grande. So in this case, it's pretty obvious that I'm talking about wishes, okay? So in this case, you're going to be translating the verb quiero as I wish to have. Okay, let's now focus in the verb querer as in to want, okay? If you are at a cafe, you can order a café with the verb querer. Quiero un café, por favor. Quiero un café, por favor. Quiero un café, por favor. So here we are just saying, I would like or I want a coffee, please. Now that we know the meaning of the verb querer, let's focus on its conjugation. Please repeat after me. Por favor, repite después de mí. Yo quiero. Tú quieres. Usted quiere. Él quiere. Nosotros queremos. Vosotros queréis. Ustedes quieren. Ellos quieren. Yo quiero. Tú quieres. Usted quiere. Él quiere. Nosotros queremos. Vosotros queréis. ustedes quieren. Ellos quieren. If you've been paying attention, you probably noticed that the infinitive form of the verb, which is querer, changes a little bit throughout the conjugation, okay? And if you notice that, congratulations, well spot. And the reason why this verb changes, it's because it's an irregular verb. Es un verbo irregular. The type of irregularity this verb has is located in the first section of the verb, which we call raíz, which means root or stem, right? So basically what happens is that the vowel e changes to ie, okay? E becomes ie, okay? In certain people making the actions, okay? So it will be yo quiero, tú quieres, él quiere, ustedes quieren, ellos quieren, okay? It's not correct to say yo quiero, you have to say yo quiero, because it's an irregular verb. But it becomes a regular verb again when you're using nosotros or vosotros. More often than not, we are using the verb querer next to another verb, okay? As I was saying before, yo quiero tener. Tener is another verb. I'm saying in Spanish, I want to have. To have is an infinitive verb, is another verb as well. So basically what you have to do in Spanish is you need to conjugate the verb querer, okay? Yo quiero, tú quieres, as we were doing the conjugation before. And the verb that is located after querer, you just have to keep it as it is in the infinitive form. So, for example, it's not correct. Yo quiero tengo. That's wrong, okay? What you have to say is yo quiero tener. Tú quieres tener. Él quiere tener. So, as you can see, querer is changing, it's being conjugated, while tener is remaining exactly the same across all these people. I'll give you a very useful example. Yo quiero hablar español perfectamente. Yo quiero hablar español perfectamente. Yo quiero hablar español perfectamente. Alright guys, thank you so much for joining me in a new video. I hope that you enjoyed today's lesson. As usual, if you have any questions, you can leave me a comment down below. Also, take the comments as an opportunity for you to practice Spanish and maybe write a sentence with the verb querer and then another verb, okay? Just a full sentence in Spanish. Muchísimas, muchísimas gracias. Thank you so much for watching today's video y nos vemos en la próxima. Hola, hola, ¿cómo están? Hello guys, how are you today? Hoy tenemos una clase sobre exclamaciones en español. Today we're gonna cover exclamations in Spanish. This is a pretty cool lesson because we are very expressive in Spanish and we are always shouting and saying our comments or opinions about something or someone, and this is very, very useful if you're gonna be interacting in Spanish, okay? So pay attention. La clase de hoy es súper interesante y yo pienso también muy importante para interactuar con otras personas en español. Como sabes, en español solemos ser muy abiertos a la hora de expresar nuestra opinión y utilizamos mucho estas exclamaciones, no solamente para hablar de opiniones, sino también para halagar a otra persona, para decir algo bonito a otra persona y también para animar. So one thing to keep in mind about this exclamation that we're going to be learning today is that we don't just use these words to express our opinions, but also to flatter other people, to say something nice about someone else, and also to cheer them on. La primera expresión es bravo. Repite, por favor. Bravo. 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 I love when English speakers say this word. It sounds so cute. Bravo. Marvelous. Bravo. Just love it. But now you know how to say it correctly. It's bravo, not bravo. If you happen to live under a rock and you never heard this expression before, bravo means amazing, how wonderful, okay? So if you find yourself enjoying a theater play or a musical or, you know, a singer, and you want to praise their performance, at the end of the show, you can stand up, clap as much as you can and shout, ¡Bravo! ¡Woo! ¡Bravo! Es muy probable que ya conozcas la expresión bravo. La utilizamos muchísimo en español para halagar la actuación o la performance de artistas. Por ejemplo, si ves una obra de teatro o si asistes a un concierto, al final de la actuación o del concierto, si quieres expresar lo mucho que te ha gustado el espectáculo, entonces te pones de pie, comienzas a aplaudir y gritas con toda la fuerza de tus pulmones. ¡Bravo! ¡Woo! ¡Bravo! ¡Olé! I love this one. ¡Olé! ¡Olé! And you have to do this with your hand, I don't know why. Esta es una expresión típica, típica de España. Se popularizó mucho con el flamenco, pero también se utiliza mucho en el fútbol y en ambientes informales de España. Es una forma de animar a otra persona. This one is an expression that we use particularly in Spain. It's a typical Spanish expression from Spain, and it started with flamenco. Flamenco, and then it became popular, and I think nowadays you also can hear it in soccer or football, in the football environment, and also in informal environments as well. So basically you use olé to cheer someone, okay? When someone is doing something amazing, you're gonna say olé. Enhorabuena! Repite, por favor. Please repeat. Enhorabuena. 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 Bien. Enhorabuena se utiliza principalmente en España, pero también en Argentina, por ejemplo. Y básicamente significa como, hey, finalmente, qué bueno, felicitaciones. This is an expression that, again, is mostly used in Spain, but we use it as well in Argentina. Basically, it's like saying like, hey, finally, how amazing, congratulations. That's what enhorabuena means. Cuando hablamos de exclamaciones en español, no podemos dejar de mencionar la estructura que más adjetivo. When we're talking about exclamations in Spanish, we can't miss or skip the expression que plus adjective. It's very simple. Es muy, muy fácil de utilizar. Let's say, for example, you're at a friend's house and you want to say that the house is very pretty, right? So all you have to do is translate the word pretty in Spanish, right? Which in this context is going to be linda, casa linda. So the adjective is linda. Mm-hmm. And then what you're going to do is you're just going to say que plus that adjective. Que linda. Vamos con otros ejemplos. Que fea. Que triste. Qué amable, qué tonta, qué gracioso, qué cómico, qué malo. Okay, so we most of the time use these ones with an adjective, but you can also use it with a noun, okay? Let's say you want to say, oh, what a man. I don't know when you would want to say, like, yeah, bueno. Qué hombre, qué casa. ¿Qué carro? ¿Qué auto? Okay, guys, I hope that you really enjoy this lesson as much as I enjoy doing this for you. Please let me know on the comments down below if you have any questions. And I would also love for you to take this as an opportunity to practice Spanish and to write your own sentence down below. Bien, muchísimas gracias y nos vemos en la próxima clase. Adiós. Bye, see you. Bye, see you next time.
Hola, soy Brenda Romagnello, tu profesora de español. Hoy vamos a hablar de mandatos en español. Vamos a hablar de qué tiempos verbales podemos usar en español para dar órdenes, básicamente. Today we're going to have a look at some commands in Spanish and what tenses we can use in Spanish to give orders, pretty much. Hoy vamos a ver tres tiempos verbales para hablar de mandatos y dar órdenes en español. Vamos a usar el presente, el presente simple, vamos a usar el modo imperativo y vamos a usar el condicional simple del indicativo. Entonces el presente y el condicional del indicativo y vamos a ver el modo imperativo. There's three tenses that we can use in Spanish to talk about commands, and that is the present tense, the simple present in Spanish, the conditional, and also the imperative mood. Vamos a analizar, vamos a empezar con estos tres ejemplos y luego vamos a ver qué tiempo verbal usamos para cada uno y lo que significa. We're going to have a look at these examples to be able to compare and analyze them and why and when would we use one or the other. Número uno. Hay que regar las plantas. The plants need to be watered. Número dos. Riega las plantas. Water the plants. Número 3. ¿Podrías regar las plantas? Could you water the plants? En el primer ejemplo estamos usando la estructura hay que está en el presente del indicativo, con el verbo haber, que es un verbo que usamos para hablar de existencia, pero que en este caso hay que significa hay una obligación y es lo usamos de modo indirecto para dar una orden. In the first example, we use hay que, which is the structure to talk about to give an order in an indirect way. Okay, this must be done, meaning maybe you should go and do it. Are you gonna do it? Or you know, in English, sometimes we say we need to water the plants. And whenever someone says that in English to me, I always go and say, we sounds like a lot of people, meaning I think you want me to go and water the plants, right? So hay que is an indirect way to give orders in Spanish. En la número dos, vamos a usar el verbo en el modo imperativo. El modo imperativo es el modo de las órdenes. Y por supuesto es mucho más directo, es la forma más directa que tenemos para dar órdenes en español. In the second one, we are using the imperative mood, which is the mood in Spanish to give orders. So there's no question here, this is direct, it's a direct order. Y la número tres, podrías, en este caso, usando el condicional, también es una forma amable o indirecta de hacer un pedido, de hacer un mandato, de pedir una orden. And in the last example, we are using the conditional tense. And this one is an indirect way to ask or request or give an order, and at the same time is polite. So the best way I would say, if you don't know, especially the person that you're talking to, is to use the conditional tense to ask or for a command or to ask for a request or a favor or to give an order. But of course, if you know who you're talking to, you know your audience very well, you can use the imperative mood and it's not rude in that situation. Para el registro formal, sobre todo dando órdenes, vamos a usar la persona usted, Muy bien, usted es la persona, segunda persona del singular y es de uso un registro formal. So whenever we want to give orders or commands in a formal way, we're going to use the personal pronoun usted, which is the second person and is the formal you, the formal register for you. Hay que completar el formulario. In this case, it could be used in a formal setting because there's no one performing the action here. It's an impersonal sentence and we can use it in this case. Llene el formulario, por favor. And using the conditional, we're going to say, ¿podría llenar el formulario, por favor? Okay, that's all for today. Thank you so much for watching. I really hope you enjoyed today's lesson and I really want to see you next class. Nos vemos. Adios.
Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hey,
no manches, Diego. Ni siquiera te rasuraste para el video. Ya ni la chiflas porque es cantada.
Bueno, pues a mí tan siquiera me sale barba y bigote, ve, a ti ni siquiera un pelo.
Ah, pasado de lanza.
El que se lleva se aguanta. Okay, guys, so, do you understand what we said before? If not, in this video we're going to give you a guide to understand the Mexican humor, so enjoy it! The Mexican sense of humor is a very particular one, and sometimes the foreigners struggle with understanding the way we express our humor, so that's why in this video we're going to try to uncover it.
Well, now, the first example we have here is albures. Sometimes Mexican humor has double sense. We talk about something, but we are saying something on the other side. We play on words. Those words are always with a sexual context. We can give you some examples of that because this video is family friendly.
That's correct. However, if you're wondering an example of it, you can look for Chistes de Polo Polo, who is a Mexican comedian,
yeah.
Or just albures.
Siempre me los hacían.
A todos. Another important thing of the Mexican humor is that we make fun of every possible situation, including the dead. Let's take, for example, the calaverita, where a calaverita essentially tells the death of a person who's still alive. For example,
Diego estaba en su casa mientras la muerte lo esperaba. En la esquina de la parada, ansiosa por su llegada.
Oh.
As Mexicans, we make fun of people, and it could be seen as bullying, but we don't do that with bad intentions. We use that as a manner of getting along with someone.
That's correct. So, essentially, the more you love your friend, the more you will be a bully with him. Sounds crazy, right?
Yeah, but it is the perfect example of what we call cuchillito de palo, which means knife made of wood that doesn't cut, but bothers a lot.
It bothers a lot. That's correct.
For example, Diego, estás bien feo.
Te estás más feo.
Eso no es lo que dice tu novia.
Mexicans are politically incorrect people. Why? Because we make fun of minorities such as black guys, Asian guys, or disabled people, poor people, or even gay people. Hey, but please don't take us too seriously. This is just part of our culture, and of course our intention is not to offend people. No, so please take it with a grain of salt. Now, just a warning, we're going to give you an example of this, so if you are a bit sensitive with these topics, skip the next 40 seconds or so, okay? So, the example.
You go first.
Oh, damn, yeah, you're right. Efraín, ¿y qué pasó con María? ¿Ya le hablaste?
No, me da mucha pena hablarle.
¿Por qué? No, no seas joto, háblale.
No, no es que sea joto, es que... Ah, ¿qué tal si me dice que no?
Eres bien joto.
Ah, ¿tú sigues yendo a tus clases de guitarra?
No, ya no puedo, no, trabajo todo el tiempo, estoy en la oficina, ya ves que trabajo como negro.
No, brother, ya deberías renunciar a eso.
Sí.
Ni siquiera te pagan tan bien.
Tienes toda la razón, me pagan como niño asiático en fábrica. Casi nada.
Everything has a sense of humor if you look for it. In the most tragic and saddest situations, Mexicans have the capability of finding the sense of humor of that situation. For example, we could find these images on the internet during and afterwards the earthquake.
Boom, 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 boom.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's not only for tragic situations, but I mean we make fun of many situations overall, from the saddest one to the most tragic one. Another example would be
Diego, creo que se va a morir mi tía.
Rayos. Bueno, pero ve el lado bueno. Tu casa ya no olerá viejito ni cigarro.
Eres un desgraciado, Diego.
Another important thing in the Mexican humor is that we tend to use apodos for our group of friends. An apodo is basically a nickname. Therefore, in our group of friends, we always have a chaparro, a short person, or a flaco, a thin person, el gordo, fat person, el negro, the brown skin or black skin person, and so on. So, for example, in my group of friends, I am el mamado, which is the strong person.
El que se lleva se aguanta. In Mexico, this is a very popular expression. It could be translated in English as if you can't stand the heat, stay out of the kitchen. And everything could be fun, everything could be love, until someone makes us pay back in kind. For example, Diego, estás bien feo.
Ah, tú estás feo.
Eso no es lo que dice tu novia.
Bueno, pero por lo menos mi novia no me ha dejado por mi primo. ¡Ey! No, espera, regresa. Te llevas y no te aguantas.
Hey there, friends of SpanishPod101.com. Thank you for watching this video. We hope you liked this. Please write your comments down below and share it with all our learners so we could reply to every comment that you have for us. Okay? Thank you and see you in the next one. ¡Hasta luego!
Bienvenidos, bienvenidos, amigos de SpanishPod101.com.
Hoy tenemos el Efras and Diego's
Comedy Show.
Y esta es tercera llamada.
Tercera llamada para el video de chistes mexicanos. ¡Comenzamos!
Laughing is a very important activity. It is even healthy for our body. And it makes the life more enjoyable. Right, Diego?
That's correct. So, Mexican jokes normally speak about five different topics. Number one, about drunk people. Number two, about an iconic character from Mexico, who we call Pepito. Number three, when we speak about other nationalities. Number four, when we speak about the hell. And number five, the classical jokes for children. Of course, there are many more topics, but these are very common ones. Now, mind you, some of these use double sense, and actually we play on words to convey something sexual. That's our humor. So, but this video is family friendly, so we're going to give you some jokes that are, and let's see if you can get them.
Yeah, let's start with the first joke. Come on. Woo! Okay, so clap your hands, babies. Pepito va con su mamá y le dice, mami, mami, ¿qué pasó, hijo? Ya no quiero jugar con mi primo el rompecabezas. ¿Por qué, hijo? Apenas va el primer martillazo y empieza a chillar.
I love you, man. Okay, so, did you get the joke? So, basically, a rompecabezas is a puzzle, but it's also we play with the words because romper is to break and cabeza is the head. So rompecabezas is, apart from puzzle, is to break your head. And of course, what happens when you hit someone with a hammer, you destroy, you break the head of another person. You see? Okay, ahora vamos con un chiste de nacionalidades. En Japón crearon una máquina que atrapaba a ladrones y, pues bueno, cuando la estrenaron, en menos de 30 minutos atrapó a 20 ladrones. Oh. Después la llevaron a Francia y en menos de 30 minutos atrapó a 40 ladrones. Después la llevaron a Italia y en menos de 30 minutos atrapó a 17 ladrones. Y en eso la llevan a México y en menos de 5 minutos se robaron la máquina.
Ok. Oye. Ok, llega alguien y dice,
negra, ¿bailamos?
Y ella, no.
¿Pero por qué?
Cuatro razones. Esto es un funeral. Usted está borracho. Número 3, el Ave María no se baila. Número 4, no soy negra.
Soy sacerdote.
¡Hombre! ¡Thank you! ¡Gracias, público!
Ok. Espero que estén disfrutando la noche con nosotros y ahora vamos a continuar con unos chistes infantiles. El primero es que había un niño tan, pero tan pequeñito que su cabeza le olía a pies.
¡Ay, qué bonito!
Está bonito. Ok, otro. Ese estuvo muy corto. Ok, llega la hija con su papá y le dice...
Papá. ¿Cómo se escribe campana?
Campana se escribe como suena.
Entonces escribo talán, talán.
Ok.
Es tu turno ahora.
Bien. Ahora vamos a contar un chiste sobre el infierno. Una vez, un alemán se murió. Y al ir al infierno, llegó y vio que cada nación tenía un infierno diferente. Entonces fue con los alemanes y les preguntó, ¿qué les hacen aquí? Entonces uno de los alemanes le respondió, aquí lo sientan en una silla eléctrica por una hora. La siguiente hora los acuestan en una cama de clavos. Y el resto del día viene el diablo y da latigazos. Psh. Entonces, el alemán todo espantado va a otras naciones y pregunta qué les hacen. Y siempre obtiene la misma respuesta. Hasta que llegó al infierno de los mexicanos. Y ahí en el infierno de los mexicanos vio que había mucha gente, mucha. Entonces, les preguntó, ¿a qué les hacen? El mexicano respondió lo mismo. Silla eléctrica por una hora. Nos acuestan en una cama de clavos la siguiente hora y viene el diablo y nos da latigazos. Entonces el alemán, sorprendido, dice, entonces, ¿por qué hay tanta gente queriendo entrar? Y el mexicano responde, ¡ah! Es que no hay luz. Y los clavos ya se los robaron todos. Además, el diablo solamente firma y se va. ¡Ríete!
Okay, that was a nice joke. Now, of course, maybe if you don't get it, it's because you don't have the cultural background. Now, let me explain why this is a very good joke. So, as Mexicans, we have the stereotype of, first of all, not paying for our bills. And this is true. Unfortunately, that's true. Most of the electricity bills are overdue. for many families. Now, we are seen as people who rob. That's not true at all. We are not robbers. But, well, we are seen like that. And number three, we are also known, especially for office jobs, that we don't really work for 8 hours, but we work much, much less. As long as the boss is not there, we can just sign, firmar, and then leave. So as you can see, most of these jokes refer to something cultural. Therefore, that's why it is important for you to know a bit of the culture in Mexico. For ending this video, we want to give you a suggestion of four of our favorite comedians that are Mexicans. The first one that I truly, truly love is Franco Escamilla.
Yeah, that is a good one. The second one could be Carlos Vallarta.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Franco Escamilla and Carlos Vallarta are estandoperos, which is a practice that came from the States, the stand-up comedy show. Well, that's now very popular in Mexico. So these two are estandoperos. We call them like that. Another one that I truly love is Platanito Show. It's a really, really, really good comedian. He's actually a clown.
Y el último, el otro también te gusta. ¿Quién es?
Oh, sí, hay otro payaso que se llama Chuponcito. Es muy gracioso también. So, les recomiendo mucho ver algunos videos de estos comediantes y, pues bueno.
Let's just take this advice. It is not available. Well,
you know, unfortunately, most of these comedians are not truly family friendly, but that's because that's our humor. You know, as we said at the beginning of this video, sometimes we speak like in double sense, so it's not suitable for children. No. So that's it for today, my friends from SpanishPod101.com. We hope that you have enjoyed this video. If so, please give us your thumbs up and share it with other learners. Also, if you have any other Mexican joke that you know or any joke, please share it with us. We want to read it. We will comment all your comments.
And please invite us to go and eat something.
Again.
They're joking. Hey there, friends of SpanishPod101.com. Once again, I'm Efraín.
And I'm Diego.
And today, we're going
to... Hey, Efra, ¿qué estás comiendo?
Un tamarindo. No, no, es solo para mí. No, no soy un codo, pero es que... Okay, do you know what we are trying to say? You're lucky because today we're checking Mexican gestures. So,
enjoy the video. Woo! One of the most essential parts of every communication is the body language. So that's why it is important for you to know the Mexican gestures, because even if you have lived here for a long time, you may recognize some of them, but maybe you don't know how to use them properly. Some of these gestures are more used by men than by women, and if women use them, they are not really well seen. So, the first one that we have is to convey yes, and it is one of the most popular gestures in Mexico. And that gesture is...
sí. And this one comes from the most popular, or one of the most popular TV shows in Mexico. And it is the Chavo del Ocho. Ting 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 ting. The second gesture here is for saying that something is long way still. For example,
Efra, ¿qué tan larga está la fila de las tortillas? Or even, Efra, ¿qué tan lejos está Puebla de aquí? ¿Y Chihuahua?
Okay, you can add this on
with that sound. Okay, now we have two more gestures that are related to money. The first one is for asking how much is something, and you obviously use it when you cannot ask the price directly. For example, when you are in a tianguis or in a flea market, you just need to point the object, the article that you're interested in, and do this. Like, ¿cuánto? Now, if something you consider is very expensive, the gesture that you will use is, for example.
Hey, Diego, ¿eso está caro?
Vámonos. So it's like, yes, it is expensive, let's go.
Another gesture we have here is the one that you use when you are in a restaurant. So you raise your hand and then you call the waiter for the bill. It is like, you write something here. We still don't know what we are writing about, but...
Greek, write something.
Yeah, you write something.
Very good. So another one that is very common is for saying the person that is in front of you, hey, you are being miserly. For that, in Mexico, we have the word codo, and we use this gesture. So, for example, Efraín, quiero unas palomitas. ¿Me las compras?
No.
Let's go.
Sí, ¿y qué?
The next one is just for saying, let's go. And the gesture is very simple. You just do this. For example, when the class is finished and everyone wants to go, it's like, hey, vámonos, vámonos.
Okay. The next one here is when you want to say after or before. For example.
Hey, ya tengo hambre. Vamos por los tacos ya ahorita.
Después.
Ah, después, ok, bueno, después de este video, perfecto.
Ajá.
Ok, so the next one is for conveying that you are in serious problems. And for that you just use with this sound. So, for example. Efra, the example.
Ah, sí.
Mi mamá te va a regañar, es su espejo favorito. Era.
Okay, okay. Let's go to the next one, okay. The next one here is when you want to have a drink and you use this one especially and usually for alcoholic drinks. Hey Diego, vamos por una cerveza.
Claro, vamos. The next gesture could be used in two different ways. The first one is for indicating the other person that you want to split half the bill or any other expense. For that, you just point that person and it's like, hey, let's split half the bill. But you can use this same gesture just for telling the other person that you want a bit of that something that he is eating. So, for example, Efraín está comiendo una rica manzana. Efraín.
No. ¿Y qué? So what? Okay, the next one here is when you ask another person if he has already eaten. For example, Diego, ¿ya comiste?
No, todavía no, pero podemos ir por unos taquitos.
Sí, and you can even use it for saying, let's go eating. Vamos a comer.
Vamos a comer, yeah. Let's go eating. Yeah, so the next one is just for saying thank you. Now, sometimes this is bad seen for foreigners, but believe us, this is actually for us a sign of courtesy. So, for saying thank you, you will just say or do this. For example,
Diego, ¿quieres un poco de esta rica manzana?
No, ya no. Muchas gracias.
Pruébala.
No.
Okay, the next one is when you're incapable of doing something. Or when you are afraid of something, or when you are just a coward. For example, Diego, vamos a esa casa embrujada.
No, me da miedo.
¿Sí?
Sí.
No seas cobarde.
No, sí.
Vamos.
Me da mucho miedo.
Bueno, a mí también me da cosa ir solo.
¿Te da cosa?
Sí. Okay, next one is when you want to say that some place is very crowded, or when... something is a lot, when you have a lot of something. For example, Diego, no vayas al café del Moro este sábado porque hay un buen de gente.
Mucha gente, mucha gente. Or even you can say, Efra, ¿tienes mucho trabajo mañana?
Y tengo un montón, es un buen.
Very good. Okay, so the next one is a gesture for spanking, and this is usually for kids, when the mothers want their kids to behave well, they will be like, hey, pórtate bien, behave well, or nalgadas, I'm going to spank you.
So, when you were a child, you would usually hear something like, hey, no hagas eso, te voy a dar.
Yeah, very common.
Okay, The next one here, you... Okay, listen carefully. You just use this one when you are with friends. Don't use it in public. And you use this when you want to go to the bathroom and the poop is, you know...
Already there, you know?
For example, Diego, ya necesito ir al baño, lo traigo así, así.
Like this. So like... Okay, okay, very good. Yeah, we're going to finish this video and...
It happened to me.
1 hour ago. Okay, so the last one is for... this is a gesture for encouraging another one for doing something that you want to do. So, and the gesture is this. Now be careful because this originally means like, hey, you are being gay. But once again, this is not really offensive. This is just a way for encouraging the other one to do something that you want to do. So, for example, Efra, hoy tengo una fiesta. Vamos.
Okay, vamos. Vamos. Esto es todo por hoy, amigos de SpanishPod101.com. Y bueno, esperamos vernos hasta la próxima. Muchas gracias por ver este video.
Y si vienen a México, no olviden llamarnos porque podemos ir a comer.
Juntos.
So, nos vemos en el siguiente video. Bye bye. Efraín, hace unos días Alondra me dedicó una canción muy bonita.
¿En serio?
Sí.
¿Cuál?
Se llama Vuelve. ¿La conoces?
Creo que no. A ver, cántala.
Dice: Vuelve, que sin ti la vida se me va.
Ándale. Muy buena. De hecho, a mí me dedicaron una canción igual. Bueno, no igual, similar. Y es de Juanes, se llama Volverte a Ver.
Ah, sí, creo que la conozco. ¿Cómo
sí,
va?
Volverte a ver es todo lo que quiero hacer. Volverte a ver para poderme reponer.
Ah, yeah. Bien, good. As you may have noticed, we use the verb volver in both of our songs. However, the song that I sang, the meaning is a bit different than the song that Efraín sang. So, in this video, we're going to clarify this verb. So, enjoy it!
The verb volver is commonly translated as to return or to come back to or to go back to. But this meaning is not enough to cover this verb properly. Because it has a broad range of meanings.
That's correct. As Efraín said, this verb could be translated as to go back to or to come back to. As in the example, extraño Cancún, quiero volver a la playa. Mind you, that we can change the verb volver a for regresar. So, I can also say, extraño Cancún, quiero regresar a la playa. Then, the expression volver a needs to be followed by a place if you want to convey to go back to or to come back to. However, we can also use an expression of time to convey the same. For example, tengo que irme pronto, pero no te preocupes, volveré a las 5 de la tarde. Another way for saying this is, tengo que irme pronto, pero no te preocupes, regresaré a las 5 de la tarde. So in this case, volver a and regresar have the same meaning, and this means to go back to or to come back.
Now, let's take a look at the sentence, quiero volverte a ver. In this case, it doesn't have too much chance when we translated it as to come back to, or to go back to, or to return. Quiero volverte a ver, in this case, means I want to see you again. Therefore, volver could also be translated as again, when combined with a verb.
That's correct. So remember the structure, volver a plus an infinitive verb means again. Now, just as a side note, we have four other ways to express again in Spanish, but we're not going to cover that in this video. For that, we're going to make another one. So remember to turn on the channel notification so you can be the first to watch when the new video is released.
So far, the verb volver has been really easy, right? But let's take a look at this sentence. Diego, la próxima semana me vuelvo a inscribir a la escuela.
Ah, qué bueno.
Sí.
So, he's saying, me vuelvo a inscribir a la escuela. Did you notice the use of the reflexive version of volver? That is, volverse. When do we need to use the reflexive verb of volver and when we need to use the non-reflexive version? Honestly, in Spanish, this is not really logical, but as a general rule, we're going to use the reflexive version of volver when the verb that he's using doesn't need a direct object. In this case, he's saying inscribir. Inscribir doesn't need a direct object. That's why he's saying me vuelvo a inscribir a la escuela. Not just vuelvo a inscribir a la escuela. No. Now, so to be sure that you got this, we're going to give you two more examples. Number one.
Mi tío José se volvió a desmayar.
He is using the verb desmayar, to faint. This is a verb that doesn't need a direct object. That's why he can use the reflexive version. Mi tío José se volvió a desmayar. It would be strange to say, mi tío José volvió a desmayar. No, you need to use the reflexive pronoun there. Number two.
Ayer volví a ver la película Jumanji.
Muy buena película. Okay, so the verb that he's using is ver. And ver needs a direct object. The direct object in this example is la película Jumanji. That's why he can't use the reflexive version. He's just saying volví a ver la película Jumanji. It would be really strange to say me volví a ver la película Jumanji. No, that even sounds awful.
The verb volver can take the reflexive pronoun, as we saw previously. But it can also take the direct pronoun and the indirect pronoun.
Oh.
Now, let's see some examples.
Hey! Oye!
Si te comes otro dulce, te vuelvo a pegar.
Okay, está bien. Tranquilo. In that case, he's using the verb pegar. The verb pegar needs a direct object. So, te is not a reflexive pronoun, it is rather a direct pronoun. Te meaning me, to me. Te vuelvo a pegar. I will hit you again. Now, let's take a look at one example of an indirect pronoun.
No le vuelvo a contar nada a mi prima.
¿Qué pasó?
Les dice a todos mi secreto. O sea, yo no tengo la culpa de haber contraído piojos.
¿Qué?
Nada.
¿Tienes piojos? ¿Qué rayos? Ok. He's saying, le vuelvo a contar nada a mi prima. The verb contar can take a direct object, but also an indirect object. The direct object could be un secreto o algo. And the indirect object is a mi prima. So, that's why he can say, no le, meaning la prima, the indirect object, le vuelvo a contar nada. Pretty easy.
Finally, we can also use the verb volverse in its reflexive form. And we can translate it as to become.
What?
Yeah! Let's see one example. Diego, una vez que entras a la universidad, tener vida social se vuelve más complicado.
Once you get into college, having social life becomes more difficult. That's definitely true. So, now that you have the verb volver under your belt, We're going to give you some examples so you can test your knowledge.
Number one, I don't want to go back home yet.
No quiero volver a la casa todavía o no quiero regresar a la casa todavía.
Number two, I'll see you again in 1 month.
Te volveré a ver en un mes.
Number three, I cleaned my car yesterday and it is dirty again.
Ayer limpié mi coche y hoy se volvió a ensuciar.
Number four, my relationship with Samantha became boring.
Mi relación con Samantha se volvió aburrida.
Okay, that's it for today. We hope that you learned a lot in this video. And please give us your thumbs up if you like it and share it with other learners. Write your comments down below. We will reply to them, okay? And see you in the next video.
Bye.
Hey.
No manches, Diego. Ni siquiera te rasuraste para el video. Ya ni la chiflas porque es cantada.
Bueno, pues a mí tan siquiera me sale barba y bigote, ve. A ti ni siquiera un pelo.
Ah, pasado de lanza.
El que se lleva se aguanta. Okay, guys, so do you understand what we said before? If not, in this video we're going to give you a guide to understand the Mexican humor. So enjoy it! The Mexican sense of humor is a very particular one, and sometimes the foreigners struggle with understanding the way we express our humor, so that's why in this video we're going to try to uncover it.
Well, now, the first example we have here is albures. Sometimes Mexican humor has double sense. We talk about something, but we are saying something on the other side. We play on words. Those words are always with a sexual context. We can give you some examples of that because this video is family friendly.
That's correct. However, if you're wondering an example of it, you can look for Chistes de Polo Polo, who is a Mexican comedian, yeah, or just albures.
Siempre me los hacían.
A todos. Another important thing of the Mexican humor is that we make fun of every possible situation, including the dead. Let's take, for example, the calaverita, where a calaverita essentially tell the death of a person who's still alive. For example,
Diego estaba en su casa mientras la muerte lo esperaba en la esquina de la parada, ansiosa por su llegada.
Oh.
As Mexicans, we make fun of people and it could be seen as bullying, but we don't do that with bad intentions. We use that as a manner of getting along with someone.
That's correct. So essentially, the more you love your friend, the more you will be a bully with him. Sounds crazy, right?
Yeah, but it is the perfect example of what we call cuchillito de palo, which means knife made of wood that doesn't cut but bothers a lot.
It bothers a lot. That's correct.
For example, Diego, estás bien feo.
Tú estás más feo.
Eso no es lo que dice tu novia.
Mexicans are politically incorrect people. Why? Because we make fun of minorities such as black guys, Asian guys, or disabled people, poor people, or even gay people. Hey, but please don't take us too seriously. This is just part of our culture, and of course our intention is not to offend people. No, so please take it with a grain of salt. Now, just a warning. We're going to give you an example of this. So if you are a bit sensitive with these topics, skip the next 40 seconds or so. Okay? So, the example.
You go first.
Oh, damn. Yeah, you're right. Efraín, ¿y qué pasó con María? ¿Ya le hablaste?
No, me da mucha pena hablarle.
¿Por qué? No seas joto, háblale.
No es que sea joto, es que... ¿qué tal si me dice que no?
Eres bien joto.
¿Tú sigues yendo a tus clases de guitarra?
No, ya no puedo, no, trabajo todo el tiempo, estoy en la oficina, ya ves que trabajo como negro.
No, brother, ya deberías renunciar a eso.
Sí.
Ni siquiera te pagan tan bien.
Tienes toda la razón, me pagan como niño asiático en fábrica. Casi nada.
Everything has a sense of humor if you look for it. In the most tragic and saddest situations, Mexicans have the capability of finding the sense of humor of that situation. For example, we could find these images on the internet during and afterwards the earthquake.
Boom, 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 boom.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's not only for tragic situations, but I mean we make fun of many situations overall, from the saddest one to the most tragic one. Another example would be
Diego, creo que se va a morir mi tía.
Rayos. Bueno, pero ve el lado bueno. Tu casa ya no olerá viejito ni cigarro.
Eres un desgraciado, Diego.
Another important thing in the Mexican humor is that we tend to use apodos for our group of friends. An apodo is basically a nickname. Therefore, in our group of friends, we always have a chaparro, a short person, or a flaco, a thin person, el gordo, fat person, el negro, the brown skin or black skin person, and so on. So, for example, in my group of friends, I am el mamado, which is the strong person.
El que se lleva se aguanta. In Mexico, this is a very popular expression. It could be translated in English as if you can't stand the heat, stay out of the kitchen. And everything could be fun, everything could be love, until someone makes us pay back in kind. For example, Diego, estás bien feo.
Ah, tú estás feo.
Eso no es lo que dice tu novia.
Bueno, pero por lo menos mi novia no me ha dejado por mi primo. ¡Ey! No, espera, regresa. Te llevas y no te aguantas.
Hey there, friends of SpanishPod101.com. Thank you for watching this video. We hope you liked this. Please write your comments down below and share it with all our learners so we could reply to every comment that you have for us. Okay? Thank you and see you in the next one. Hasta luego!
Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hola, mi nombre es Romina Romaniello. Hi everybody, how are you today? My name is Romina Romaniello. Today I have a great lesson for you. I'm going to teach you 6 negative words in Spanish. Hoy tenemos una clase fantástica para todos ustedes en casa. Vamos a enseñarte 6 palabras negativas en español. Número 1. No. 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 Seguramente ya conoces la palabra no. Es probablemente una de las primeras palabras que aprendes en tu primera clase de español. Surely you already know the word no. It's one of those words that you first learn on your very first lesson of Spanish. No significa no. No means no. Duh. Lo interesante para recordar con la palabra no es la colocación. ¿Dónde debes colocar no? En español es importante recordar que siempre tienes que colocar no antes del verbo. When you're using the word no in Spanish, you have to remember that you always have to put that before the verb, okay? That's where its location is. It's always before the verb, never after. Let's see a couple examples. Vamos a ver algunos ejemplos.
No me gusta comer brócoli. No me gusta comer brócoli. No me gusta comer brócoli. No he visitado Tailandia. No he visitado Tailandia. No he visitado Tailandia. Por las mañanas no quiero tomar té ni café. Por las mañanas no quiero tomar té ni café. Por las mañanas no quiero tomar té ni café.
Número 2. Nadie. Repite, por favor. Nadie. 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 ¿Qué significa nadie? ¿Sabes? What does nadie means? Do you know? Nadie significa no one. It means no one in English.
Nadie vino a clase ayer. Nadie vino a clase ayer. Nadie vino a clase ayer. Yo no veo a nadie sospechoso en mi calle. Yo no veo a nadie sospechoso en mi calle. Yo no veo a nadie sospechoso en mi calle.
Número 3. Nada. 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 Nada significa nothing. Nada means nothing in English.
No pasó nada interesante en la fiesta. No pasó nada interesante en la fiesta. No pasó nada interesante en la fiesta. And this is for the guys. No estoy pensando en nada. No estoy pensando en nada. No estoy pensando en nada.
Número 4. Tampoco. Repite, por favor. Tampoco. 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 En español, cuando hablamos con alguien y esta persona nos cuenta las actividades que no le gusta hacer o ciertas opiniones sobre las que no está de acuerdo, podemos decirle a esta persona con la palabra tampoco que nosotros también estamos en la misma línea de pensamiento. Basically, when we are talking to someone and this person is telling us about, you know, things or activities that this person doesn't like to do, or this person doesn't do, or maybe opinions or ways of thinking that this person doesn't agree to, then we can sort of agree with this person to say yo tampoco, me neither. Es más fácil explicar con un ejemplo. It's a lot easier to explain with an example. Let's see.
No quiero salir de casa esta noche. Yo tampoco. No quiero salir de casa esta noche. Yo tampoco. No quiero salir de casa esta noche. Yo tampoco.
Número 5. Nunca. Repite, por favor. Please repeat. Nunca. 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 Nunca significa never.
Nunca he comido nada picante. Nunca he comido nada picante. Nunca he comido nada picante. Nunca puedo dormir bien cuando viajo. Nunca puedo dormir bien cuando viajo. Nunca puedo dormir bien cuando viajo.
Y finalmente, número 6. Otra opción es la palabra jamás. Repite, por favor. Jamás. 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 Nunca y jamás significan nunca. Significa never. Nunca means never. There is also another option in Spanish, which is jamás. So nunca and jamás are synonyms.
Jamás he comido nada picante. Jamás he comido nada picante. Jamás he comido nada picante. Jamás puedo dormir bien cuando viajo. Jamás puedo dormir bien cuando viajo. Jamás puedo dormir bien cuando viajo.
Recuerda, por favor, que cuando utilizas nunca, jamás y tampoco en español, sí o sí debes colocarlas antes del verbo. Please remember that in Spanish, whenever you're using tampoco, nunca or jamás, you always have to put these three words before the verb. Aunque hay una excepción, por supuesto. But of course there is an exception. Cuando quieres utilizar en una oración no, con jamás o nunca, ¿bien? Tienes que colocar nunca y jamás después del verbo. When you want to use the word no and the words nunca or jamás in the same sentence, please remember that first you have to put the no, then the verb, okay? So you're going to be putting that no before the verb, and then after that you're going to be putting jamás or nunca, depending on which one you want to use. Let's see this with an example. Vamos con un ejemplo. No volveré a tomar tequila jamás. No volveré a tomar tequila jamás. No volveré a tomar tequila jamás. ¿Sabes qué significa esta frase? Do you understand what I'm saying here? I'm basically saying, I will never drink tequila again. Por cierto, esta frase es una frase que yo misma he dicho. Mucho tiempo atrás me emborraché terriblemente con tequila y al día siguiente tuve la peor resaca de mi vida. La peor. Fue terrible. Desde ese entonces yo prometí nunca jamás en mi vida volver a tomar tequila. Hoy no puedo siquiera tolerar el olor del tequila. By the way, this is a statement I've made in my life, and it's actually a true story. I will never ever in my whole life drink tequila again. There was this time I got really drunk on tequila. I had the worst hangover in my whole life. I felt that my head was about to explode. So ever since then, I can't even stand the smell of tequila. I can't. Bien, espero que te haya gustado esta clase. I hope that you enjoyed today's lesson. Please let me know in the comments down below if you had a similar story with tequila, okay? I would love to know from you guys in the comments down below if you ever got drunk on tequila like I did and you can't stand tequila anymore. En los comentarios, por favor, dime si te has emborrachado muy, muy mal alguna vez con tequila y hoy por hoy no soportas el tequila. Muchas gracias y nos vemos en la próxima clase. Adiós. Thank you so much, guys, and I will see you in our next class. Bye.
Hola, soy Brenda Romaniello, tu profesora de español. Hoy vamos a hablar del verbo haber y el uso impersonal de este verbo tan particular en español. Today we're going to have a look at the impersonal use of the verb haber in Spanish. So there's two different uses for the verb haber in Spanish, and one of them, which is not the one that we're going to talk about today, is the one when we want to talk about a past tense with phrasal verbs in Spanish, to say something like he visitado, he vivido, I have lived or I have visited a place. That's not the use that we're going to use, that we're going to see today when we use el verbo haber in Spanish. We're going to use it to talk about impersonal sentences and how we use the verb haber in these impersonal sentences and what it means. This verb, we use it to talk about the existence of things in Spanish. We use it to talk about the existence of things or people, and it has a little, it's very weird to translate it into English. It doesn't have a specific description that we can use. We just use it to talk about the existence of things, and you're going to notice, you're going to see what I mean when we use a few examples. So we're going to start off with the present tense in the indicative mood in Spanish, and when we use I, when do we use this impersonal use for I, and why is it impersonal? So a verb is impersonal, a sentence is impersonal in Spanish when there is no person performing the action. So something simply happens or exists, and that's why we use this verb in the third person singular, and we don't change it matching anything else in the sentence. I means there is and there are in English. So as you can see, that it means two different things in English, and in English we're going to use there is if whatever follows is a singular object or person, and there are if we're talking about two people or things or more. In the case of Spanish, we're just going to keep it in the singular form. We're going to always say I regardless of whatever follows being a singular or a plural thing. Por ejemplo, quiero que respondas esta pregunta. ¿Qué hay en una escuela? ¿Qué hay en una escuela? So for example, I want you to answer this question. What is there in a school? What can you find in a school? What exists in a school? Podemos decir, hay libros, hay estudiantes, en una escuela hay maestros, en una escuela hay mesas, hay sillas, etc. Puedes ver que aquí estamos describiendo la existencia de cosas o personas que hay en una escuela, que existen, que suceden en una escuela. So there are students, books, teachers, tables, seats, chairs. All this is to describe what we can find, what is there in a school, what does it exist? What can you find in a school using hay, there is, and there are. ¿Hay empanadas en tu país? Are there empanadas in your country? ¿Hay mucha gente en la cola? Is there a lot of people in the queue? No hay papel para la impresora. Tenemos que comprar más. There's no paper for the printer. We have to go and get more. So now let's talk about the past tense, and we're going to compare había versus hubo. So these two verbs are in the past, but remember we have two different past tenses in Spanish, for one in English, which is the imperfecto and the pretérito. Había is conjugated in the third person of the imperfecto and hubo in the third person singular of the pretérito. So now we're going to have a look at what is the difference between them when we use one instead of the other. And why would that be? Había, we're going to use it in the imperfecto to talk about when we describe something or someone in the past, a situation, a person, anything that has to do with descriptions in the past, we're going to use the imperfecto, and therefore we're going to use había in this particular case. Hubo, we're going to use it in the pretérito to talk about a past action, that a single past action that had no duration in the past and is not describing anything. It's just simply telling a story, moving a story forward, and just saying that simply something happened. Vamos a ver algunos ejemplos con había. Cerca de mi casa había un parque muy bonito con muchos árboles. So close to my house, there was a park nearby, yes, with lots of, very pretty, with lots of trees. Here we are describing what was close to my house, what was near my house, and therefore, because it's a description in the past, we're going to use había and not hubo, which is the imperfecto, no? We need to use the imperfecto in this case. Había mucha gente en la playa porque hacía calor. Había mucha gente en la playa porque hacía calor. There were a lot of people at the beach because it was really hot. So as you can see here, we're describing the beach. What was it like? You can see it in your head. You can see this picture of there were many people and the weather condition as well, which is also used in the imperfecto here because we're describing the weather. Nos perdimos y no había nadie para pedir direcciones. So we got lost and there was no one around to ask for directions. There was nobody. There was no one around. So we got lost and there was nobody around to ask for directions. Yeah, so here we're describing this very unpleasant situation. And you can feel the desperation, right? And it's just that description, see? There was no one around to ask for directions. Meaning you can see the people like looking around and seeing if they can find someone. Vamos a ver algunos ejemplos con hubo. Por ejemplo, hubo un accidente esta mañana. See, there was an accident this morning. I'm not describing the accident, I'm not describing the scene, I'm not describing the people involved, I'm just saying what happened this morning. Hubo un accidente. There was an accident this morning. Hubo muchas cosas que no me gustaron de él. There were a few things that I didn't like about him. So here I'm not describing the person, I am not describing the scene, the setting, my feelings. We're not describing here anything in the past, we're just saying that simply my opinion, what my opinion was about this person that I met or I spoke to here. There were many things that I didn't like about him. No hubo ni un solo día de calor este mes. There wasn't even one hot day this month. Here, we're not describing the weather. We're not saying that it was or it wasn't. Here, what we're saying is that during that specific period of time in the past, something didn't happen. Muy bien, eso es todo por hoy. Espero que te haya gustado la clase. That's all for today. I really hope that you enjoyed this lesson and I hope to see you in the next one. Adiós, nos vemos. Hola, ¿qué tal? Mi nombre es Brenda Romagnello y soy tu profesora de español. Hello everybody, I'm Brenda Romagnello and I'm your Spanish teacher. Today we're going to have a look at some Spanish prepositions and more specifically, 5 differences between por and para in Spanish. Por and para are 2 prepositions in Spanish that give English speakers a headache every time they want to think about which one they have to use when they speak Spanish. And the reason being that in English, most of the time we can translate them as for, but we're going to have 2 different and distinctive prepositions in Spanish. So that could be a little confusing when you have one meaning, but then you have 2 different prepositions to use in Spanish that actually mean the same. So what we have to do is learn when we use one preposition and when we use the other. Diferencia número uno. So the first difference is that we are going to use por to talk about motive or reason. And this could be when we want to say because in Spanish, when you can replace it with because, you know that you have to use por because we're talking about reason. We're going to use para when we want to talk about the purpose. Now, sometimes the goal, the objective, sometimes people go like, hang on a second, reason and motive and purpose seems to be the exact same thing, but it's not. One is going to be the motive, the reason why you do something. The other one would be the target, the purpose. Por ejemplo, estudio español por mi familia. Trabajo para poder ganar dinero. So as you can see here, one is the reason for studying Spanish, which is my family, and the other one is just the purpose. I work so that I can earn money. So that would be when you want to replace a word to see if it makes sense, you should replace por with because, and you'll see if it makes sense. And then you can replace para with in order to or with the purpose of, and then you'll see that if it makes sense or not and when to use one preposition or the other. Número dos. So the second difference between por and para is that we are going to use por to talk about through. When we want to say that we are using a physical space and moving through it, compared to para, that para is a destination, it means towards. So por is through, para towards. Por ejemplo, and I want to see if you can see the difference here. Camino por el parque, camino para el parque. So as you can see here, camino por el parque, it means that I'm walking through the park. So I am actually in the park, going and walking around it. Camino para el parque, the park is the destination, I am walking towards it, I am not at the park yet. Número tres. Number three, the difference would be that we use por to talk about periods of time. So anything that has to do with a period of time, we're going to use por, and we're going to use para to talk about a limit or a deadline. So a time that is limited, limited time. Por ejemplo, viajé a Madrid por 5 días. Estudio español por las mañanas. Ceno por la noche. Me voy de vacaciones por 5 semanas. As you can see, all these time periods, we need to use por because we're talking about a period of time. La tarea es para el lunes. El trabajo es para el próximo mes. As you can see, the difference here, one is the deadline or the limit of time, and por, we are going to use it for periods of time. Número 4. Number 4, we're going to use por to talk about an agent, and we're going to use para to talk about a recipient. Por ejemplo, El Quijote fue escrito por Cervantes. El regalo es para Ana. So, as you can see here, the difference is that Cervantes wrote the book, so he's the agent, he's the person that wrote or performed the action, and el regalo es para Ana. Ana is the recipient of the present. She will get the present. Número 5. Number 5, here we are going to use por to talk about anything that has to do with maths or numbers. So when we use it for multiplication, price, medium, or also percentage, anything that has to do with that, we're going to use por and not para. And we're going to use para to give opinions. So let's have a look at some examples. Dos por dos es cuatro, el 3% de la población. Viajo por tren. We're going to use para to give opinions. We can say para mí, which would be a synonym of in my opinion. Para mí, los gatos son más lindos que los perros. So, in my opinion, you can use this phrase to express your opinion, and we're going to use para and not por. Okay, so those are the main differences between these two Spanish prepositions, por and para. I really hope that you found this lesson helpful and that now you can see a little bit better the difference between these two prepositions in Spanish. In the comments below, I would love to hear from you and see if you can write an example using por and para, and I would love to read your examples in the comment section. Like this video if you did, and also subscribe to the channel. I will see you next class. Muchas gracias. Adiós.
Hola, soy Brenda Romagnello, tu profesora de español. Welcome to another Spanish class. Hoy vamos a hablar de los adverbios. Aquí, allí, acá, allá. So today we're going to talk about the adverbs aquí, allí, acá y allá. So they're here and there. So aquí, allí, acá, allá. These are all adverbs of place. And what we're indicating with adverbs of place is a location. What is the difference between these four? Why do we have four here? So let's start with aquí and allí. So aquí and allí will be, they are basically opposites when it comes to location, and we'll use them depending on the point of reference, how far you are from the object of the or the person that you are referring to. So aquí significa here. So we're talking about a point of reference from where you're talking, from your perspective. Here, aquí would be close to the person that is talking. If I say allí, allí means there, and there it implies that the point of reference is here, and then the location of the object or the person that we're referring to is further away from us. So we're gonna say aquí, allí. Aquí, allí. When we talk about aquí and allí in terms of the distance, we are always pointing out the difference. We're always pointing out the distance from the speaker, from the person speaking. Por ejemplo, If my sister Romy asks me, hey, where is the pen? I can say, the pen is here. El bolígrafo está aquí. Aquí. Here. And even if she is further away from me, I'm still gonna say aquí because I am talking about the point of reference me from the pen being myself. Another example, ¿dónde quieres las flores? ¿Aquí o allí? Where do you want the flowers? Here or there? Now let's talk about acá and allá. So acá we use it for here, so it means here, and we use it for the point of reference being something close to the speaker. Yeah, so the place, the location for the object or the person that we are referring to is close to the speaker. And when we say allá, it's actually the opposite. So the location of the object or the person that we are referring to is further away from where we are at the moment. So the same example for acá en allá would be ¿dónde quieres las flores? ¿Acá o allá? So where would you like the flowers? Here or there? Hang on a second. Did we say that aquí was here and allí was there and acá is here and allá is there? What is the difference between aquí and acá, allí, allá? Do you know the difference? ¿Sabes cuál es la diferencia? Okay, so the difference is where we use these words. For acá en allá is more particular of Argentina, Uruguay, and certain parts of Colombia. And for the majority of the other Latin American countries and in Spain, they are going to use more the variety of aquí and allí. So basically the difference is depending on who you're talking to, what part of the Latin America the speaker is from, and also perhaps if you're traveling, where you're going, what country are you visiting, and what variety of the language they're going to use. But they basically mean the same. Acá, aquí, they both mean here, and allí, allá, allí, they both mean there. Which one should you pick? Which one should you use? Well, that is entirely up to you. Of course, we understand each other all throughout Latin America and Spain. It's kind of the same as in English if you are from England or from the States or Australia. It doesn't matter where you are. And if you say chips or French fries or crisps or whatever, you know, there are certain differences, but of course we understand each other, right? Well, that's exactly the same in the Spanish world. If you say allá or acá in Spain or Mexico, people will understand. They will probably just assume that you've been to Argentina or Uruguay or parts of Colombia or that you learned Spanish there. And the same the other way around. If you use aquí or allí in Argentina, for example, people will assume that you learned Spanish more in Mexico or Spain, etc. But of course we understand what you want to say. So it doesn't matter, really pick whichever language variety you feel more comfortable with and the one that you actually want to use. Muy bien, estudiantes. I really hope that you understand this lesson. It's very simple, the differences, but I think that's a very highly asked question because we see it everywhere and they seem to mean the same. So what is the difference? Now we know. Muchas gracias y nos vemos en la próxima clase. Thank you very much and I'll see you next class. Adiós, hasta luego.
Hola, soy Romina Romaniello. Bienvenidos a una nueva clase de español. Hello, my name is Romina Romaniello and welcome to a new Spanish lesson. Para la clase de hoy vamos a trabajar conectores textuales. In today's lesson, we're going to talk about text connectors, as we call them in Spanish, but I think in English these are called transition words. Los conectores textuales hacen justamente eso, conectar ideas dentro de un texto. So transition words do exactly that. They help to the flow of ideas in a text, okay? So they connect ideas one with the other. So when you are reading a text, you can feel that there's a flow and it helps It helps your reader to guide their mind through the reading. That's the intention of the transition words. Existen muchas categorías de conectores textuales. Vamos a ver algunos ejemplos. There are actually quite a few numbers of transition words or phrases. So basically we can organize these ones by categories. Now we're going to see a few examples.
Para empezar, tenemos conectores para organizar el discurso. So to start, we have transition words to organize the text, the speech or the ideas. Vamos a ver unos ejemplos. Let's see a couple examples. Por favor, repite después de mí. Please repeat after me. Para comenzar. Antes de nada. En primer lugar. En segundo lugar. Por último. Por un lado. Por otro lado. A continuación. Para seguir. Después. Luego. Finalmente. Para terminar. A la derecha de la pantalla tienes la traducción de cada una de estas palabras para organizar el texto. So, to your right, you can see the translation for each of these transition phrases or words. Introducir un tema. Introducing a topic. En cuanto a. Con respecto a. Acerca de. Con relación a. En relación con. Estas son bastante parecidas a las que tienen en inglés. These ones are very similar to the ones that you have in English as well. Por favor, también recuerda que estas palabras pueden tener traducciones diferentes dependiendo del contexto. Please also keep in mind that these phrases or words can have a different translation to the one that I'm showing you on screen, depending on the context. Añadir ideas. Adding new ideas. Además. Siempre utilizamos además. Es una palabra que es muy frecuente en español. So, además, is actually a word that we use quite often in Spanish, not just for text, for written text, but verbally as well. No solamente para escribir, sino que también lo utilizamos mucho para hablar. Así mismo. Igualmente. Al mismo tiempo. De igual manera. Continuamos. Let's continue. Ahora tenemos explicar o aclarar. So now we have transition words for explaining or clarifying. Es decir. O sea, en otras palabras, dicho de otra manera, en efecto, conviene subrayar. Esta es un poco difícil, así que vamos a repetirla un par de veces. The last one is a little bit tricky or difficult to pronounce, I believe. So we're going to revise this a few times, okay? Please repeat. Vamos a repetir. Conviene subrayar. Conviene subrayar. Conviene subrayar. Introducir una opinión personal. Introducing a personal opinion. Para mí. En mi opinión. Yo creo que. A mi parecer. A mi entender. A mi juicio, según mi punto de vista, personalmente, indicar duda o introducir una hipótesis, expressing doubt or introducing a hypothesis. I hope I said that right. Es posible, posiblemente, es probable, probablemente, a lo mejor, quizás. Tal vez. Indicar consecuencia. Indicating consequences or effects. En consecuencia. Por consiguiente. Por lo tanto. Como resultado, indicar causa, indicating cause, porque, ya que, a causa de, debido a, visto que, resumir, summarizing, en resumen, para resumir, en pocas palabras, en definitiva, en suma, concluir o terminar, concluding, en conclusión, para terminar, para finalizar, para concluir. Por último,
a la hora de utilizar conectores textuales, es muy importante que no utilices demasiados. Si utilizas demasiados conectores textuales, el texto parece un poco extraño, es un poco difícil de leer. La idea es que uses unos cuantos. When you're using transition words in a text, I think balance is key, okay? It's very important for you not to overuse these connectors or transition words, because what happens is that your text looks, it sounds weird, okay? And the reading doesn't flow as nicely as it should. You just want to sprinkle them in the text. You don't want to overuse them. Just remember, balance is key when you're using transition words. Además, muchas veces cuando escribes un conector están acompañados por una coma, así que ten en cuenta eso. Recuerda escribir las comas cuando estás utilizando conectores textuales. Another thing to keep in mind is that most of the transition words that we use are accompanied by a coma. Bien amigos, muchas gracias por ver el video de hoy. Espero que les haya gustado. That's it for today amigos. Thank you so much for watching today's video and I will see you in our next class. Nos vemos en la próxima clase. Adiós.
Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com. Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hey there, friends of SpanishPod101.com. I hope you already know our names, but I'm Efraín.
And I'm Diego.
And today we're going to check many ways to say that someone is dead. Yeah, what a topic, right?
Yeah, so I hope you enjoy this video.
Woo!
Hey, Yefra, oye, ¿te enteraste lo que le pasó a Pedrito?
No, ¿qué le pasó?
Ya chupó faros.
¿Y por qué le das por chupar faros?
No es algo gracioso, quiero decir que se murió, que ya se petateó.
No manches.
No sabemos lo que le pasó.
¿Y de dónde viene la expresión chupar faros?
Pues no tengo ni la menor idea.
¿Y qué significa?
No lo sé, pero sí sé que en español tenemos muchas expresiones para decir que alguien se murió.
Ok, in this video, you will check many ways to say that someone is dead. So let's go with the first expressions and then we're going to interview some people so they can...
Tell us if they know any other way for conveying the same idea.
Thank you. Well, the first expression that you heard before was ya chupó faros. Y esta expresión es muy, muy interesante, ya que cuando a alguien se le fusilaba, para calmar a aquellas personas que se les iba a fusilar, se les daba cigarros, y los cigarros eran de marca Faro. Por eso se le llama así, chupar faros.
Bien, otra expresión que tenemos y que escuchamos previamente es ya se petateó. Y esto viene de algunos pueblos en México donde normalmente la gente es muy, muy pobre y no pueden comprar un ataúd para enterrar a los muertos. Entonces, de esta forma, ellos únicamente utilizan un petate, which is sort of a rug or a carpet, it's very similar to it, y envuelven al cuerpo muerto y, bueno, lo avientan a un hoyo junto con otros cuerpos muertos. I know it sounds awful, but that's what people here normally do when they don't have money.
Okay. El siguiente es ya se lo llevó el patas de cabra. Y esto es porque se le concibe al diablo como alguien rojo y con patas de cabra. Muy similar al dios griego Pan. Tal vez por eso.
Correcto. Otra expresión que a mí me gusta mucho es ya colgó los tenis. Y ya colgó los tenis viene de una tradición deportiva en donde literalmente cuando una persona muere, le quitan los tenis y los amarran las agujetas y lo avientan a un cable de electricidad. Y en México, mientras tú caminas por las calles, puedes ver en estos cables de electricidad algunos tenis. Eso quiere decir que la persona de portadora de esos tenis ya murió.
Otra expresión que a mí me gusta mucho es lo sacaron con los pies por delante. Y es que en la tradición católica, si alguien era santo o era converso, la primer parte de su cuerpo que entraba al cementerio era la cabeza. Y cuando alguien era pecador o no creía, lo primero que entraba al cementerio mientras lo cargaban eran sus pies, las patas, ya que así no podía encontrar el camino de regreso.
Oh.
Muy interesante, ¿no?
Exactamente. Otra expresión es únicamente ya fue, que es done, ya fue.
Okay, the next one is ya estiró la pata. Y al parecer este viene de una vieja expresión y de una vieja canción española cuyos versos van como y murió como el burro, con la pata estirada y con el hocico arrugado.
Muy bien. Ok, otra expresión que a mí me gusta es ya se lo quebraron. Y esto es muy similar a decir que alguien lo mató, que alguien lo asesinó. De ahí viene la expresión, ya se lo quebraron. Quebrar is like to break, so someone broke him.
Okay, one expression that comes really interesting for me is ya se lo cargó el Pifas. Y el Pifas era un ratero muy famoso en el siglo XIX. Y además de robar, se cargó a varias personas. Y jamás lo mataron. Y jamás lo encontraron. No se supo quién fue. De ahí viene la expresión, ya se lo cargó el Pifas.
Another expression very similar to the one that I used before, ya se lo quebraron, is ya se lo cargó el payaso. Like basically a clown carried body. So we don't really know why we use a clown for that expression, but it's like that. Ya se lo cargó el payaso.
Okay, another expression is ya lo cafetearon. En los velorios se da café cuando alguien muere. Por eso el café se vuelve un verbo y al ser conjugado se dice ya lo cafetearon.
Another expression that I personally like is ya pasó a mejor vida. Y esta es una expresión que normalmente utilizan las personas mayores para decir que una persona ya está en el cielo. Y bueno, supuestamente en el cielo, pues ya tienes absolutamente todo. Por eso, ya pasó a mejor vida.
Muy bien. Ok, so we have some questions here. Could you use one of these expressions in one sentence?
Yeah.
Could you give us an example?
Why don't you try it and put it in the comment box right below? Okay, Yefra, so I have another idea. Why don't we go and ask two people if they know any other way for conveying the idea that someone is dead? Because, you know, in Mexico, we have given already some examples, but we have many, many, many more ways to say that someone is dead. So, what do you think about it?
Let's do it.
Yeah, let's go.
Hola, y bueno, ¿tú qué expresiones conoces para decir que alguien ya se murió?
Lo besó la flaca, se puso la pijama de madera, se lo expropió Salinas, se convirtió en comida de gusano, valió queso, bailó con la más fea, ya cantó la gorda y creo que ya. Ah, se petateó.
Y a ver, pregunta del millón. ¿Y podrías decir un enunciado con alguna de esas expresiones que dijiste?
Pues en sí mismas son, no son.
A ver, no sé. ¡La que
vea! ¿Y tú qué expresiones conoces para decir que alguien se murió?
Ya se nos fue, ya la cargó el payaso, ya valió madres, chupó faros, escupió el chicle.
Ok, interesante. That's it for today, my friends from SpanishPod101.com. We hope that you have enjoyed this video. If so, please give us your thumbs up and share with other learners. Also, don't forget to subscribe to this channel. And if you have any comment, please put it in the comment box right below. We will personally reply to them. So, we hope to see you in our upcoming video.
Hello, my friends from SpanishPod101.com. I'm Efraín.
And I'm Diego.
And today we're gonna have a great topic. We're gonna learn how to compare in Spanish. So enjoy the video!
So, what's the deal with the comparisons in Spanish? Basically, in Spanish we can compare in three different ways. We can compare for superiority, superioridad, equality, igualdad, and inferiority, inferioridad. Let's start with superioridad.
For superiority, you use más que. It can be used with nouns, adjectives, and verbs. Let's start with nouns. Yo tengo más músculos que Diego.
That's not true. Anyway, so in this case, Efraín is saying yo tengo más músculos que Diego. In this case, the word músculos goes in between más and que. The nouns, either countable or uncountable, goes in between. So I can also say tengo más imaginación, uncountable, que, or yo tomo más agua, que, and so on. Now, let's see an example with an adjective.
Yo soy más moreno que Diego.
That's definitely true. So, in that case, moreno goes in between más and que, just like the nouns. Finally, let's see how it works with verbs.
En este video, Diego va a hablar más que yo.
Very good. So, with verbs, with actions, más que goes together, and then you just compare the action. En este video, Diego va a hablar más que yo. Now, keep in mind that after que, you will say yo. You will not say me. In English, you will rather say Diego speaks more than me. But in Spanish, no, it's like if we were saying more than I. So keep that in mind.
Now, let's see inferiority. It works exactly the same as superiority. Yeah, it's just that you rather use menos que instead of más que. Let's see some examples we saw in the previous one. Yo tengo menos músculos que Diego. Now, the next one. Diego es menos moreno que yo. En este video, yo hablo menos que Diego.
So, as you can see, the collocation is exactly the same as más que. Now, a note on superiority and inferiority. We have already seen that we can use más que and menos que for comparing nouns, adjectives, and verbs. But be careful, because we can also use más de and menos de. In this case, we're going to compare quantities. So we use this for countable nouns, not uncountable. So let's see two examples. Number one.
Diego, ayer salí con una chica y descubrí que tiene más de 40 años de edad.
Wow. Muy grande. Te pasaste de lanza.
Me manché, ¿verdad?
Sí. Now we can also use menos de. Let's see an example.
Diego, hoy hice menos de 15 minutos para llegar a tu casa.
Pretty easy, right? Now let's see equality. For the equality, we use tan como and tanto como. Tan como works for the adjectives, but wait, let's see how tan works all by itself. Tan means so, and it helps for intensifying an adjective. For example, ¿qué haces, Efraín?
Estoy viendo a mi novia, es tan hermosa.
So, in this case, he's saying she's so beautiful. So tan intensifies beautiful. Now, if you want to compare, you just need to add como. So, for example, I could say, mi novia es tan hermosa como la tuya.
Pero Diego, tú no tienes novia.
Anyway, so let's see now tanto como. Tanto como works for comparing the verbs. And just as más que and menos que, tan como goes together. Let's see one example. Efraín, vamos a pedir una pizza, pero una chica, porque tú no comes mucho. Yo como 6 rebanadas y tú 2.
No, Diego, mejor una mediana. Yo como tanto como tú.
Ok, perfecto. Finally, let's see the nouns. For the nouns, be careful because we can compare either countable nouns and uncountable nouns. For the countable nouns, we will use tantos como or tantas como. Be careful because that depends on the gender, tantos, masculine, tantas, feminine, and we add the S, tantos and tantas. So, let's see one example.
Diego, en México hay tantos mexicanos como sombreros.
Oye, eso es racista.
I was just kidding, my friend.
Well, anyway, so in that case, he's using tantos sombreros because you can count the sombreros. You can say one sombrero, two sombreros, three sombreros, and so on. Now, we can also compare the uncountable nouns, but for the uncountable nouns, we would rather use tanto and tanta. For example, in Mexico, hay tanta vida nocturna como en Amsterdam.
¡Eso es!
We use tanta como because we cannot count the nightlife. We cannot say one nightlife or two nightlives. No, that's why we just say tanta vida nocturna como.
So now, let's see one exercise for you to practice. I have 50 pesos.
And I have 20 pesos.
What comparisons can you think of? I'll give you 5 seconds. Okay, we will give you some possible answers. Yo soy más rico que Diego. Diego tiene menos de 50 pesos. Yo tengo más de 20 pesos.
Or even you can say, Diego no tiene tanto dinero como Efraín. And although in this case I am using the equality form, I am also negating it. So basically, I'm saying I don't have as much money as Efraín.
That's it, my friends from SpanishPod101.com. We hope you enjoyed this video. If so, please give us your thumbs up and let us know your opinion here in the comment section. ¡Hasta luego! Hasta ahí está, eso estuvo bien.
Hey there, friends of SpanishPod101.com. Today we bring to you... Oh, sorry. I'm Efraín.
And I'm Diego.
And today we bring to you idiomatic expressions with the preposition por.
So, enjoy the video.
Woo!
So, the preposition por has several idiomatic expressions that you should know in order to be fluent. Sometimes these expressions are kind of easy to translate in English, but sometimes they are not. So, since we have several expressions, we have split this video in 2 videos. Therefore, in this one, we're going to tell you 15 expressions, and at the end, we will see a sketch where we can use it and you can test your listening skills. So, first of all, let's watch this sketch without subtitles.
Basta ya, Diego. Quiero mi pago por adelantado. De otra forma, no te puedo seguir ayudando con Instagram.
Ay, por el amor de Dios, Efraín. Estoy consiguiendo demasiados seguidores. Bueno, por ahora solamente tengo 10, pero cuando llegue a 50,000 podremos generar mucho dinero.
Está bien, pero quiero un porcentaje de las ganancias.
Ok, ¿cuánto?
El 60%.
¿Qué? ¡Estás loco! ¡Eso es demasiado! ¡Es mi imagen la que se está exponiendo!
Pero yo soy el que hace las fotos, yo soy el que las edito, yo soy el que las promociono, yo consigo los lugares... Además, esa es mi cámara. Por eso, creo que debo de recibir el 60%.
Ok, está bien. Pero, por desgracia, para empezar a ganar dinero aún tenemos mucho por hacer.
Bien. Empecemos. Por lo general, los influencers muestran sus talentos. ¿Por qué no probamos cantando?
Sí, claro, por supuesto.
Ah, ok.
Bésame. Bésame. Como si fuera esta noche la última vez.
¿Por qué no probamos contigo dibujando? Creo que cantando lo podemos dejar para después.
Oh, ok, sí, claro, solo necesito una pluma. ¿Tienes una pluma?
Está por aquí.
Ah, excelente. Ok. Diablos, por lo visto, tampoco es mi talento.
¡Caray! ¿Cuál podrá ser entonces? ¿Me pasas mi celular, por favor? Creo que lo vi por allí.
Sí, mira, está por aquí, está en mi trasero.
¿Me lo pasas, por favor?
Sí, claro.
Ok. veamos. ¡Oh! ¡Por fin! Encontré algo en lo que eres bueno. A mucha gente le gusta cómo se ven tus brazos. Podríamos sacarles foto.
¡Ey! Tienes toda la razón. Por supuesto, ¿por qué no lo pensé antes? Puedo mostrar mis brazos en las fotos. Creo que eso podría llamar a muchos seguidores. Pero, ¿de casualidad no tienes aceite para hacerlos más brillosos?
¿Qué?
Bueno, por cierto, también a muchas personas les gusta ver mi abdomen. Por ejemplo, cuando me pongo así.
¡No, no, no! ¡Para, para!
Did you understand what we said in the sketch? Okay, we will give you some idiomatic expressions that we used there. So, the first one is por adelantado. In advance, Diego, quiero mi pago por adelantado.
¿Qué pago?
No sé.
Okay. The next one. Por desgracia. Unfortunately. Por desgracia, no tengo dinero.
Okay. Next one. Por ahora. For now. Por ahora, no necesito dinero. Quiero descansar.
Okay. The next one. Por ejemplo. Por ejemplo. Pues sí, para descansar podemos ir, por ejemplo, al cine, o descansar aquí, ver una película en la televisión.
Sí. Okay, the next one is por allí, around there. ¿Dónde dejé mi libro para descansar?
Oh, mi, está por allí.
Oh, okay.
The next one is por eso, therefore. Efraín, tenemos que trabajar muy duro y por eso tenemos que terminar al menos el día de hoy 2 o 3.
Por amor de Dios, for God's sake. Por amor de Dios, Diego, ni siquiera me he curado de la tos y quieres grabar y grabar.
Ok, tienes toda la razón. The next one, por favor, please. For example, por favor, Efraín, tienes que cuidarte. Vamos, tápate, ciérrate esa chamarra.
The next one is por aquí, around here. Oye, dejé mis pastillas por aquí, pero...
Sí, observas que se comió mi perro hace rato.
Ok. So, the next one, por fin, finally. Efraín, por fin tengo novia. Después de tanto tiempo, por fin tengo novia.
Oh, ok. Por lo general, generally. Por lo general, chicos como tú no encuentran novia. Solo relaciones libres. ¡Qué asco! Yuh.
Siguiente. Por casualidad, or especially in Mexico, we say de pura casualidad. By any chance or by chance. For example, Efraín, ¿por casualidad tienes 5 pesos que me prestes?
Sí, ¿para qué?
Quiero comprar algo en la tienda. No te importa, ¿tienes 5 pesos?
Sí. Ok, the next one is por ciento. Percent. Diego, quiero mi 50% de este video.
Ay, Efraín, tú sabes que solo vas a recibir el 10%. Sí, ok. So, the next one is por lo visto. Apparently. Por ejemplo, por lo visto, ya se hizo de noche y ni siquiera lo noté.
Next one. Por cierto.
By the way.
Por cierto. Vamos a ver el sketch nuevamente, ahora con subtítulos.
Eso es correcto. So, let's watch it.
Basta ya, Diego. Quiero mi pago por adelantado. De otra forma, no te puedo seguir ayudando con Instagram.
Por el amor de Dios, Efraín. Estoy consiguiendo demasiados seguidores. Bueno, por ahora solamente tengo 10, pero cuando llegue a 50 mil podremos generar mucho dinero.
Está bien, pero quiero un porcentaje de las ganancias.
Ok, ¿cuánto?
El 60%. Okay.
¿Qué? Uh-huh. Estás loco, eso es demasiado. Es mi imagen la que se está exponiendo.
Pero yo soy el que hace las fotos, yo soy el que las edito, yo soy el que las promociono, yo consigo los lugares. Además, esa es mi cámara. Por eso creo que debo de recibir el 60%.
Ok, ok, está bien. Pero, por desgracia, para empezar a ganar dinero aún tenemos mucho por hacer.
Bien, empecemos. Por lo general, los influencers muestran sus talentos. ¿Por qué no probamos cantando?
Sí, claro, por supuesto.
Ok.
Bésame. Bésame mucho. Como si fuera esta noche la última vez.
¿Por qué no probamos contigo dibujando? Creo que cantando lo podemos dejar para después.
Oh, ok, sí, claro, solo necesito una pluma. ¿Tienes una pluma?
Está por aquí.
Ah, excelente. Ok. Diablos, por lo visto, tampoco es mi talento.
¡Caray! ¿Cuál podrá ser entonces? ¿Me pasas mi celular, por favor? Creo que lo vi por allí.
Sí, mira, está por aquí, está en mi trasero.
¿Me lo pasas, por favor?
Sí, claro.
Ok. veamos. ¡Oh! ¡Por fin! Encontré algo en lo que eres bueno. A mucha gente le gusta cómo se ven tus brazos. Podríamos sacarles foto.
¡Ey! Tienes toda la razón. Por supuesto, ¿por qué no lo pensé antes? Puedo mostrar mis brazos en las fotos. Creo que eso podría llamar a muchos seguidores. Pero, ¿de casualidad no tienes aceite para hacerlos más brillosos?
¿Qué?
Bueno, por cierto, también a muchas personas les gusta ver mi abdomen. Por ejemplo, cuando me pongo así.
¡No, no, no! ¡Para, para!
That's it for today, my friends from SpanishBowl101.com. We hope that you have enjoyed this video. If so, please, please give us your thumbs up and share with other learners. That will truly, truly help us a lot. Also, if you have any comment, opinion, doubt, or something that you want to tell us, please leave it in the comment section right below. Nos vemos en el siguiente video. ¡Hasta pronto!
Want to speed up your language learning? Take your very first lesson with us. You'll start speaking in minutes and master real conversations. Sign up for your free lifetime account.
just click the link in the description.